conflict and the immense sacrifices they've made. And here at the Royal Albert Hall tonight, we pause to reflect in the company of Her Majesty the Queen, members of the armed forces and a host of stars at the Royal British Legion Festival of Remembrance 2017.
Thank you. Your Majesty, Your Royal Highnesses, ladies and gentlemen, this is a year of notable anniversaries. We gather for this year's festival on Armistice Day, the 11th day of the 11th month, when people come together in a spirit of remembrance and in a spirit of solidarity with all those who serve today and have served in the past. We remember our shared history, and we will listen to the voices of those who've known the pain of conflict and those affected by it. In 2017, we are marking a century of service by women in the British Armed Forces. And to celebrate 100 years of their exceptional contribution, we've been speaking to three generations of women from each of the services.
I joined the Wrens because my father and grandfather were in the Navy, and my three brothers were all in the Navy. I was the first female in my family, but it didn't seem odd because everybody was joining up to do something.
My first taste of the army was at University Officer Training Corps at Exeter, and I liked the challenge. I liked to be pushed a little bit physically and mentally.
I first wanted to join the RAF when I saw the Red Arrows, but not the Red Arrows flying, actually it was the Red Arrows engineers, and I saw them also performing as a team, and that's something that I just wanted to be part of.
I became a cipher officer, decoding secret messages. I think the men were rather nervous of us, really, because they weren't used to having females around, but they were all very helpful and very polite and kind.
In 2015, I became the first female college commander at the Royal Military Academy Sandhurst and had the opportunity to influence nearly 2,000 people coming through the commissioning courses. It's fantastic. It's such an opportunity to work with really talented individuals.
My current job is the senior engineering officer on a Typhoon squadron, so I lead the team of engineers responsible for the serviceability of the aircraft, so making sure they're ready for the flying program. And Typhoon are really important because they're really our first line of defense. I feel proud of my achievements. I've been to Afghanistan twice, and earlier this year I came back from my Typhoon squadron supporting Middle Eastern operations.
One has great pride in having been a Wren, and also in the part that women have played in the First World War, which was the beginning of it, and the many wars that they have been involved in since then.
When I am down and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened me, then I am still and wait here in the silence for you to come and sit a while with me.
Ladies and gentlemen, can we welcome the torch of remembrance carried by Squadron Leader Gemma Lonsdale with Lieutenant Colonel Lucy Giles and our citation reader Joan Picton, accompanied by 100 women past and present of Her Majesty's Armed Forces.
raise me up to more than I can.
At this festival, we remember those who have died or have suffered physical or mental injury in defense of our freedoms. We respect their sacrifice by committing to protect those freedoms and to care for those who suffer. We stand in unity with those who come from all parts of our diverse nation to serve our country today in locations far from families and homes. We celebrate the opportunities of the 100 years since women were fully enrolled in the armed forces, pioneers of a path now trodden by thousands of service women. In honor of all who serve and have served, this torch of remembrance burns ever higher, brighter, and stronger.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I underline our thanks to the 100 service women, of course to Melanie C for singing for us, and to our citation reader, former Wren Joan Picton, who, by the way, is 97 years old. Well, in this year of anniversaries, it was 75 years ago, in 1942, at the midpoint of the Second World War, that the Royal Air Force Regiment was officially formed. Well, this evening, to celebrate this milestone anniversary, the Queen's Colour Squadron, a unit manned exclusively by the officers and airmen of the Royal Air Force Regiment, bring their remarkable drill to the Royal Albert Hall, supported by the musicians of the Central Band of the Royal Air Force. Thank you.
The Battle of El Alamein took place 75 years ago, when the Germans drove us out of Dunkirk and the Japanese drove us out of Singapore. We were the only people available to fight, and that was in the deserts of Africa. I was 18 in 1936, where I joined the Royal Corps of Signals, and I was posted to Cairo. I had never been abroad at all. I was just a country boy. El Alamein was just a railway station in Egypt, but we had been there for 4 months, building up so that we outnumbered the enemy 4 or 5 times. One night, about 1,000 of our guns opened up at once, shelling the Germans on the other side of the line. War is a nasty thing to explain. Seeing charred bodies of your pals laying out of tanks, it's not a nice subject. El Alamein was the first battle that we actually won hands down. To me, it seemed as though it might be the beginning of the end of the war. And from then on, of course, the Germans kept on retreating. They never advanced once more.
This is not the end. It is not even the beginning of the end. But it is perhaps the end of the beginning.
I was away from my parents for 7 years. I was at around 100 battles in 15 different countries. We signed on to do a job, and we did it to the best of our ability. That's the way I feel about it all.
Well, after the war, Winston Churchill would say of the North Africa campaign, "Before Alamein, we never had a victory. After Alamein, we never had a defeat." It was a decisive victory in a year that had also seen tragic losses. The fall of Singapore was another definitive episode in the Second World War, taking place in 1942. 75 years on, we remember those landmark battles, and of course we recognize the courage and the sacrifice of so many. And at this year's festival, we really are privileged to be joined by two veterans of those campaigns. 99-year-old Len Burritt and Dr. William Franklin, who's 105 years old. Can we acknowledge their contribution, please? Festival's warmest greetings to you both, gentlemen. Well, many from that remarkable generation of men and women are cared for by the Royal Hospital Chelsea. So let's please give our traditional welcome to the in-pensioners joining us tonight at the festival. Pensioners at the festival once again is Regimental Sergeant Major Pierce Lally of the Irish Guards. The oldest in pensioner in the group tonight, 88-year-old Les Walker. Sergeant Major Walker served in the Army for 37 years. The youngest in pensioner in this group, 67-year-old Hugh Craig, who served in the Army for 22 years. This year, the Royal Hospital Chelsea admitting their first veterans of the Gulf War. There are 14 female in-pensioners at the Royal Hospital. We have two with us tonight, Barbara Wilds and Staff Sergeant Marjorie Cole, who's 73. She's been an in-pensioner since 2009. We have another exceptional milestone to mark tonight. Dame Vera Lynn celebrated her 100th birthday earlier this year, and for many, of course, Dame Vera's iconic music kept the nation smiling and warmed the hearts of so many throughout the Second World War. So please give a very warm welcome to Alfie Bow, accompanied by dancer Natalie Lowe and ensemble, for their tribute to the original Forces Sweetheart.
When the lights go on again all over the world, and the boys are home again all over the world, and rain or snow is all that may fall from the skies above, a kiss won't mean goodbye. When the lights go on again all over the world, and the ships will sail again all over the world, then we'll have time for things like wedding rings, and free hearts will sing. When the lights go on again,
well, in the year of Dame Vera's birth, 1917, British and Commonwealth forces were taking part in one of the most costly and one of the most traumatic battles of the Great War, the Battle of Passchendaele. It's very difficult for us, of course, to even imagine the immense suffering of these men. But in the interviews that follow, conversations recorded decades ago, the voices drawn from hundreds of thousands of British and Commonwealth forces powerfully convey the reality of that time.
Passchendaele was the infantryman's graveyard. We called it the slaughterhouse. And even the most seasoned veteran felt he'd be lucky if he got there and came back.
On that morning, the 31st of July, we were told we were going over the top. The terrain was very, very difficult. Shell holes. Some of them you could drop a house in.
When a shell arrived, the noise would grow into a great crescendo. And at a certain point, your nerve would break and you'd throw yourself down in the mud and cringe in the mud till it was past.
As you laid down on the ground, you could literally feel your heart pounding against the ground. And in a continuous bombardment, which lasted sometimes for hours, the emotional strain was absolutely terrific.
We heard one of their big ones coming over. I was too damn tired even to fall down. I stood there. Next, I found myself face downwards in the mud. And I thought to myself, well, if this is death, it's not so bad.
When it came to the point when we went into action, really, I was scared stiff. I should never forget the three I lost behind me. That upsets me more than anything.
The worst thing for me was Passchendaele. That's where we were really, right in the thick of it, and it was just horrible, the mud and the shocking waste of life. Passchendaele.
There was no chance of getting wounded and getting a blighted one at Passchendaele. You'd either get through or die.
I would say that people came out of Passchendaele simply numb. Numb, mentally and physically.
It was a terrible place, just a sea of mud everywhere. If you got off the duck boards, you'd got no chance whatsoever. You just fell in the mud and you were drowned.
I was tired of seeing infantry sinking back in that morass, never to come out alive again.
No one wanted to go to that sector. The horrors of
Passchendaele. Grief of the people in losing a generation of young men led to the desire to create and install fitting memorials to those who never returned. In 1917, a century ago, the Commonwealth War Graves Commission came into being. Today, in 23,000 locations around the world, the Commission looks after the graves and memorials of 1.7 million British and Commonwealth servicemen and women who died in two world wars. No distinction is made on the basis of rank or race or creed. They simply ensure that, in Kipling's words, their name liveth forevermore.
With proud thanksgiving, a mother for her children, England mourns for her dead across the sea. Flesh of her flesh they were, spirit of her spirit, fallen in the cause of the free. Solemn the drums thrill, death august and royal, sing sorrow up into immortal spheres. There is music in the midst of desolation, and a glory that shines upon our tears. They went with songs to the battle. They were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady and aglow. They were staunch to the end, against odds uncounted. They fell with their faces to the foe. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years contemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. They mingle no more with their laughing comrades. They sit no more at familiar tables of home. They have no lot in our labor of the daytime. They sleep beyond England's foam. But where our desires are, and our hopes profound, felt as a wellspring hidden from sight, to the innermost heart of their own land, they are known as the stars are known to the night, as the stars that shall be bright when we are dust, moving in marches upon the heavenly plain. As the stars that are starry in the time of our darkness, to the end, they remain.
This tradition of remembrance, the solemn and formal reminder of millions of lives lost, is just as important today as it was 100 years ago. It involves a necessary coming together, and it provides some comfort for those relatives and friends who've suffered loss. Royal Marine Corporal Seth Stevens was killed in southern Afghanistan on the 1st of July 2010, and his family wanted to pay this tribute.
I never expected to hear the news that my husband had been killed in action. Never in a million years had I dreamt that that was going to happen to me. And when you get given that news, the first thing that comes to mind is that you have these two vulnerable children that you've got to take care of and protect.
My dad was always really adventurous. He never really took life too seriously. We were his girls and he protected us always.
I was 15, so I was at secondary school. I think I definitely grew up quite quickly. Dad had always asked me to look after Mum and Molly when he went away, being, I suppose, the oldest, not that I was physically old. But I think I kind of took that role as I need to step up and fill some shoes.
I was 11 when Dad died. At first, I just thought it couldn't be true, and I didn't for quite a while. Even at the funeral, I was in denial. It took about a year or more, really, to properly let it sink in.
I pretended to myself, really, that he's still away, and possibly until quite recently, I continued with that, and that was kind of my coping mechanism, really, is he's always been away, he'll come back.
Life's been very different, and for a while it felt really empty. But I know that I've got two amazing family members left, and we're still really close.
I couldn't be more proud of the children. I think the way they have managed themselves over the last 7 years is incredible. The endurance that they've shown, the resilience that they've shown, they have been remarkable.
I know that he saved many other lives, and I know that I wouldn't want anyone else to go through what I went through as a child, to be missing out on a father. So I feel really proud, and I definitely would say he's a hero.
As ever, a dignified and supportive welcome for the bereaved families here at the Festival of Remembrance at the Royal Albert Hall. Heather and Molly Stevens, the daughters of Royal Marine Corporal Seth Stevens, are leading the families into the festival tonight. And just behind them, we have William and Caroline Foster, whose son, Private Victor Foster of the Ulster Defence Regiment, was killed in a bomb attack in Northern Ireland back in 1986. And among the group, we also have Sarah Adams, whose son, Private James Prosser of the Royal Welsh, lost his life in Afghanistan in 2009. Sarah O'Connor, who lost her brother, Sergeant Robert O'Connor, in Iraq in 2005. Among them too, Rachel Prosser, who lost her partner, Warrant Officer Class 2 Leonard Thomas, in Afghanistan in 2012. Janice and Peter Fullerton are the parents of Lance Corporal James Fullerton of the Royal Regiment of Fusiliers, who was killed in Afghanistan back in 2009. The representatives of the bereaved families with us tonight, being acknowledged by political leaders and members of the Royal Family and everyone here at the Royal Albert Hall.
Forces Friends aims to support older veterans who are suffering from loneliness to help them overcome the problems that come with that. The British Legion actually provided the original funding for the pilot project, and the friendships are mutually beneficial.
Tom's 98 and you know, he's a great guy. I volunteered for Forces Friends because the thought of somebody who was a veteran sitting on their own and, you know, having nobody to talk to was just too much for me. I definitely wanted to go and do that.
Well, I did 22 years in the Army, and when I left the Army in 1962, it was quite a lot different in Civvy Street. Sometimes I get a bit lonely. I've missed the comradeship of all your friends and that.
Hi, how are you? Meeting up with Tom does combat my loneliness. My husband's away a lot with the Air Force, so I enjoy and look forward to meeting up with them. And because I'm a military wife, I definitely know exactly how he feels if he is lonely.
She comes round, brings the cakes, makes the tea. And I'll tell her about all my experiences in the army.
Tom is part of a special generation because they've gone through this experience that we'll never realise in our lifetime anymore. Yeah. And they're heroes, really, aren't they?
She keeps me company for a couple of hours, you know, because sometimes I don't see anybody hardly for a week to talk to.
I just get a feeling of well-being, of giving something back. I don't know whether I enhance his life, but he definitely enhances mine.
You with the sad eyes, don't be discouraged, oh, I realize it's hard to take courage in a world full of people. You can lose sight of it all. Darkness inside you can make you feel so small. But I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love. Let them show your true colors, true colors, beautiful.
Yes, our thanks once again to Tom for his special contribution to our festival tonight. Well, in the past 12 months, UK military personnel have provided vital humanitarian aid and supplies to those Caribbean islands devastated by hurricanes Irma, Jose and Maria. Well, the deployment included over 200 Royal Marines who returned to the UK just last month after the clear-up operation. With their tribute to the work of the Royal Navy, please welcome the band of Her Majesty's Royal Marines, Portsmouth.
Thank you. There were two hurricanes. They were both Category 5, which is the most severe category of hurricane. The damage for some of the islands has been absolutely catastrophic. HMS Ocean is in the Caribbean. She is part of a large task group of almost 2,000 people drawn from all three services. It is the largest UK military deployment anywhere in the world, and we are here supporting the British Overseas Territories and Commonwealth countries.
The hurricane was one like no other. It has devastated the island. When I drove around, I felt like I was in despair. I cried, I wept like a baby.
It's terrible. The only time any of us have ever seen anything similar is in the movies, in a film. If you see that 90% of an island has been demolished or flattened, you just can't fathom what that actually means until you're actually on the island.
The British military is really welcome, and actually they're a lifesaver. In some instances, they came and brought us key commodities and food and stuff.
We were out on the ground helping with the clear up, whatever was necessary. So that might be distributing aid, helping people clear, you know, debris and the likes, and helping the community get back on its feet.
I know when I came here today, looking at the classrooms, it's heartbreaking. It's nice to know that we're here doing something good. It's what I joined the Navy to do. I think it's what everyone joined the Navy to do, that we could do some good and help people that needed help.
I truly want to give God thanks for the British military. They came to our rescue at a time of very need. You know, we needed it here.
In my 21 years of military service, having served in Afghanistan, Bosnia, Northern Ireland and the likes, this has been a very different environment to work in, but nevertheless very rewarding, and I'm privileged to be part of it.
Going home quietly.
So the drums have been laid in preparation for our service of remembrance, which can begin once the men and women of our armed forces have joined us in the hall. We start the muster with the Royal Navy. So we have 110 representatives in all for the Royal Navy, from the ships and the shore establishments, the air stations and the submarines of the Royal Navy. And those establishments include HMS Collingwood, because these are the new recruits in training. And Collingwood is the Royal Navy's largest training establishment. In fact, it's the largest naval training organisation in Western Europe. But many other shore establishments and organisations represented here too as part of the Royal Navy presence. We're joined too by Queen Alexandra's Royal Naval Nursing Service, 8 representatives led by Lieutenant Kirsty Leslie, who joined the service in January last year, based in Plymouth. The men and women who provide life-saving care on the front line and assistance with rehabilitation. Music telling us the Royal Marines are here, from 40 Commando, led by Lieutenant Nicholas Foster, recently returned home after a month-long visit to the Caribbean to help with the clear-up operation following the hurricanes there. The Royal Navy Reserve, led by Sub-Lieutenant Chris Sampson-Jones, made up of around 3,000 men and women, many of whom have previously served with the Navy. Royal Marines Reserve, 4 of them from the City of London unit. And joining us too, the Royal Fleet Auxiliary, 4 of them led by First Officer Jonathan Church, civilian man fleet, delivering worldwide support for the Royal Navy. The Army. We have 110 representatives again, this time for the Army, and the music telling us very firmly that we have the Grenadier Guards joining us, 30 representatives from the Guards Division, 9 Megan Company, led tonight by 2nd Lieutenant Thomas Holmes from Leicestershire. Grenadier Guards, the most senior of the 5 regiments of foot guards formed in 1656 by King Charles II. We have 10 representatives from the Royal Tank Regiment. It's the oldest tank unit in the world, formed in the First World War. The Army Air Corps, celebrating their 60th anniversary this year. Prince of Wales is their Colonel in Chief. The Brigade of Gurkhas, Captain Surendra Kumar Gurung and Captain Dilip Kumar Rai, they are the 2 orderly officers nominated for the festival this year. Queen Alexandra's Royal Army Nursing Corps, 10 of them led by Major Patrick Wilson, also among them Captain Karen Cook, whose great-grandfather served in the First World War and whose 2 grandfathers served in the Second World War. And a very big contingent from the Army Reserves joining us at this year's festival. We have the Royal Yeomanry Westminster Dragoon Squadron, led by Lieutenant Matthew Saunders. We have 135 Geographic Squadron Royal Engineers, led by Warrant Officer Class 1 Martin Brown. We have 71 Signal Regiment, and we have 144 Parachute Medical Squadron. Squadron is the only reserve medical unit with parachute capabilities. The Royal Air Force. bombed towards the end of the First World War, the 1st of April 1918, the Royal Air Force, the oldest independent air force in the world. 110 representatives here too, led by Squadron Leader Graham Ford and Flight Lieutenant Natasha Sierley. We have representatives drawn from 33 of the Royal Air Force stations and joint service units, civilian establishments, not just around the UK, but around the world. They're here from Akrotiri and Ayios Nikolaos. More familiar, perhaps, Bryce Norton and Lucas and Northolt and Marham. The Royal Air Force Regiment, the Queen's Colour Squadron. The representatives at high-profile events such as state visits, but also fully capable combat units, of course, as well. Princess Mary's Royal Air Force Nursing Service joining us, led by Flight Lieutenant Hannah Gilmore, Flight Lieutenant Sean White, providing all kinds of health care for defence personnel. Royal Air Force Police, it is the world's oldest Air Force Police Service, formed in 1918. Joining us too, the Royal Auxiliary Air Force, led by Squadron Leader Ian Andrew James Ham. The Volunteer Reserve Force, consisting of personnel who serve on a part-time basis, many experts among them. We also have the Royal Air Force Volunteer Reserve and a representative of the University Air Squadrons. There are 15 of them situated around the United Kingdom. The Merchant Navy. Thirty representatives in all, 20 from the Merchant Navy Association, 10 from the Merchant Navy Welfare Board, and they include 5 serving cadets who've joined us tonight. During the Second World War, some 5,000 British merchant vessels were sunk. More than 29,000 merchant seamen lost their lives in that conflict. The 5 cadets, by the way, all currently training at the Wasatch Maritime Academy, which is in Southampton. The Royal British Legion and the civilian services. Solid representation of the British Legion, of course, the people involved in the poppy appeal and others at the Legion's poppy factory. But also, lots of people here from the civilian services. St. John Ambulance, for example, St. Andrew's First Aid. 2 representatives of the London Air Ambulance. I'm mentioning them because they're among those sent out to the Grenfell Tower fire in June of this year. They deserve probably a special mention in the 2017 festival for their contribution. The muster is complete. The service of remembrance can begin.
There's definitely a mantra within the army that says you're never off duty, really. You need to run into chaotic situations and just try and act as best you can.
We heard a lot of screaming and shouting and people running away, and realised there was a terrorist attack going on.
I was one of the lucky ones that night at London Bridge. My luck, I suppose, started with the fact that the first person to stumble across me had battle training.
As soon as we came up onto the bridge, you could see the sort of trail of casualties that the vehicle had left.
The van crashed about 6 feet away from me. And then I had one of the terrorists straightened into my face. I was the first person that particular guy stabbed.
Being off duty didn't influence my reaction in any way, and I ran in towards the Globe pub, which is where I found Richard lying on the floor with a huge stab into his back.
I don't know where he came from. He just suddenly, I felt that there was someone standing next to me saying everything's going to be fine, and he stayed with me while the shots were being fired and bouncing all around the Borough Market.
while he was just about clinging on to consciousness, got him back to where we knew the ambulances would be waiting. And I ran back into the inner cordon to help the next casualties.
We were able to apply first aid and compressions and stem bleeding. At least if you hit the basic casualty drills that is ingrained in us, you're going to do some good.
Pete and I crossed paths while providing CPR to one woman.
We didn't realise that each other were in the military at all. We just kind of got on with trying to check her airways.
I carried on giving her CPR for about half an hour until, unfortunately, she was pronounced dead. And then... Sorry.
When I look back at the night, I feel that it was a horrible event, but everyone was wanting to lend a hand.
It was great to see everybody working so well, be them in uniform or be those people who are just out with their friends that night.
There are lots of people that contributed to my well-being, not least Lieutenant Bambridge. Me and my family are eternally grateful to him.
Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome Captain Pete Bryan, Lieutenant Jared Bambridge, and Richard Livett, accompanied by members of our emergency services who attended the scenes of the London and Manchester attacks.
Read all about, read all about, oh.
The festival organist once again is Peter Crompton, organist emeritus at the Royal Hospital School, Holbrook. It's his 21st year at the festival. The National Chaplain to the Royal British Legion is the Right Reverend James Newcomb.
We are here in the presence of God to remember with thanksgiving and sorrow those whose lives in world wars and conflicts past and present have been given and taken away in the cause of justice and freedom. To pray for all who in bereavement, disability and pain continue to suffer the consequences of fighting and terror, and for the Royal British Legion in its ministry of care and support for them, and to commit ourselves, young and old, to work in penitence and faith for reconciliation between the nations of our troubled world, that under God, people of every race and creed may be at peace. These thoughts and prayers we offer in the words that Jesus taught. God Almighty, Creator of all, we thank you for our Sovereign Lady, Queen Elizabeth, Patron of the Royal British Legion. We pray for her and for those of every belief, religion, and race who serve together in her armed forces and in her government. As we pray also for all those who bear responsibilities for the well-being of our nation, the Commonwealth and the world. Please grant us a renewed spirit of respect and reconciliation, and unite us all in love of you and our neighbors. Enable us to build harmony in our families, our communities, our nation, and our world. So guide our paths and lead us in the ways of righteousness, that our lives may speak of your justice and mercy, now and forever. Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things.
It's time for the second congregational hymn as we approach the act of remembrance and the still moment when the poppies fall.
Teach us, good Lord, to serve thee as thou deservest, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward, save that of knowing we do thy will, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun And in the morning, we will remember them. When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we gave our today.
And sharing their thoughts on Remembrance are six members of the Centenary Intern Programme at the Commonwealth War Graves Commission.
Coming from a military family, I've always known the importance of remembrance. However, I never truly understood the enormity of the sacrifice until I worked in a Commonwealth War Graves Commission cemetery. Throughout my life, I therefore pledge to spread the word about their sacrifice, because we must not forget.
Remembrance for me is my ancestor, Captain Alfred Charles Bratt, who died in the mud of Passchendaele. Remembrance is also our family friend, Marine James Robert Wright, who fell in Afghanistan. Two men, nearly 100 years apart, how different were they really? Remembrance is not about the battles or the parades. It is about the people.
Remembrance is not something that can or should be forced. Rather, it grows through a greater awareness of the sacrifices made for us. As young people, we should remember our war dead by encouraging everybody to understand that they too had dreams, ambitions, and futures.
In our work, we strive to remember every story, from the heroism of our own ancestors, such as my great-great-grandfather, to the sacrifice made by those who lost their lives in war, so that we today may live in peace.
It is now our responsibility to carry the torch of remembrance for future generations, to ensure that its fire is never extinguished. In doing so, it reminds us of the horrors of war and ensures that the sacrifice a generation gave for our tomorrow will never be forgotten.
We see the names, we see the white headstones, and we see spectacular monuments, but we should not forget the life, the love, the laughs, and the loss behind them. To remember is to learn from their sacrifice and to strive for a better world.
The final hymn is one selected by Queen Victoria for her Diamond Jubilee in 1897. The words by John Ellerton, the tune is St. Clement.
Thank you.
God grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to the Church, the Queen, the Commonwealth, and all people, peace and concord. And to us and all his servants, life everlasting. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Bringing the festival to a close, Garrison Sergeant Major Andrew Stokes, the man in charge of all of tonight's military arrangements here at the Royal Albert Hall. And that brings the Festival of Remembrance of 2017 to an end. But the events of this Remembrance weekend will culminate tomorrow, when the Queen and members of the Royal Family will gather in Whitehall at the Cenotaph. Our coverage begins at 10:20 on BBC One with David Dimbleby. But for now, from all of the BBC team at the Royal Albert Hall, good night.
First day at a special school?
It's not a special school. It's a specialist base.
Can we stop pretending that it's normal?
If you tell me you don't want to get back together with Eddie, then I will leave tonight.
That made me feel desperate.
Thanks a bunch.
We're going to be all right, aren't we?
The A word. Continues Tuesday at 9 on BBC One.
Now on BBC One, Kate Silverton with the Saturday evening news.
Donald Trump says Russia's President Vladimir